মানে আজই যোগাযোগ করুন।
আমাদের এখানে বাংলা ভাষা সহ আরো কোনটি ভাষায় কথা বলা হয়।
প্রাক্তন ইমিগ্রেশন প্রসিকিউটর মিস্টার ব্রেটস দিবেন আপনাদের সকল প্রকার আইনি সহায়তা। যোগাযোগ 212-267-2555 732-313-0075 bretzlaw.com।
প্রিয় দর্শক, আমন্ত্রণ জানাচ্ছি আমাদের নিয়মিত ল বিষয়ক অনুষ্ঠান ব্রেটস কোভেন এলএলসি থেকে। আমাদের সাথে নিয়মিতভাবে আছেন মিস্টার ক্যারি অ্যান্ড মিস আইলিন। দর্শক, আপনারা জানেন আমরা নিয়মিতভাবে এই অনুষ্ঠানে ইউএস ইমিগ্রেশন নিয়ে কথা বলে থাকি। আজকেও সে ধারাবাহিকভাবে আমরা সেই ইমিগ্রেশন নিয়ে কথা বলবো। তো আজকের বিষয় আমাদের হচ্ছে, আমরা আজকে কথা বলবো A1 ভিসা নিয়ে, প্লাস আমরা কথা বলবো ডাকা নিয়ে, দাপা নিয়ে। তো দর্শক, চলুন আমরা কথা বলি আমাদের লয়ারের সাথে। হ্যালো মিস্টার ক্যারি, হাউ আর ইউ?
গুড ইভিনিং জামিন, থ্যাঙ্কস ফর হ্যাভিং আস টুনাইট।
থ্যাঙ্ক ইউ। হ্যালো মিস ক্যারি, হাই লিন, হাউ আর ইউ?
আই এম গুড, এন্ড ইউ?
আই এম গ্রেট। অলরাইট মিস্টার ক্যারি, অ্যাজ ইউ নো দ্যাট দাপা এন্ড ডাকা হ্যাজ বিন সো ফার আই হ্যাভ সিন দ্যাট ইটস they're not giving any more visas for that. What's the reason behind it?
So let me just clarify, the original DACA that was done 3 years ago, that still exists. If you got DACA and you want to renew it, you are in the original group of people, you're eligible. What has stopped is only two things: the proposed DAPA plan, parents of children, and that application period wouldn't begin until May anyhow, and the expanded DACA for people who are a bit older. And it's only temporarily stopped. A federal judge issued an injunction saying that President Obama's actions were illegal. That is going to be appealed.
Right.
There are three levels of federal court. This was a low-level federal court.
Right.
It's got to go to the Court of Appeals and probably the Supreme Court, and will go so rapidly.
Okay.
Very quickly, every legal scholar, law professor, expert on the constitutionality of what Obama did,
right,
said that this judge is wrong. So people should just sit back and relax. Nothing else has changed.
So,
yeah, well, with the exception of those people who could do the expanded DACA, they're the ones who have to put it on hold, because that application period would have started on the 18th, and they did the injunction on the 17th, I think.
Right.
So those people looking to get their work authorization through DACA that were over 32 when this came out in 2012, they just need to wait for the final outcome, as Kerry said.
Right. But nothing else in terms of enforcement priorities. If you're not a criminal and you got a deportation order from 10 years ago, you're not being picked up and being deported.
I see.
Low priorities are still low priorities. That hasn't changed.
For example, a regular person doesn't know what DAPA means and DACA means. Give me a, like,
okay,
brief it down.
Right. So President Obama, in his frustration that Congress has not enacted any immigration reform, we have approximately 13 million people who are undocumented, either crossed the border without inspection or overstayed their visa, but they're here working, they're part of our system. In his frustration, said, look, people who came here as children,
Right.
Came here before they were 16 years old.
Right.
Had 5 years in the U.S. as of June 2012, and either in high school, graduated high school, or had certain other work experience, and weren't over 32.
Right.
In June of 2012. I'm going to guarantee to you, you're not being deported as long as I'm president, and I'm going to give you a work authorization.
Right.
It's called deferred action.
Right.
Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals, DACA. That program still exists in its original form.
Right.
So those people are able to renew their work authorization. People who never applied before that are in that category can apply now. On November 20th, 2014, if you remember, we were sitting here watching Obama do it live, and we commented on it afterwards.
Right.
In that speech, he did a number of things. He expanded DACA to include
No age limit.
No
so
age
you didn't
no
have to be under the age of 32 in June of 2012.
And
2012.
You could have arrived here as late as 2010.
Correct.
As long as you were under 16 when you arrived, you would still be eligible. So that's the expanded DACA.
I see.
And DAPA, Deferred Action for Parental Accountability.
Right.
That is for people who have been in the U.S. for 5 years and have either a resident or a citizen child as of November 2014. And so those last two things, the expanded DACA and the DAPA, are temporarily on hold through this injunction filed by 25 conservative governors. No accident that they picked a federal court in Texas to bring this lawsuit. And this judge is extremely conservative and is wrong.
Right.
So people should just not sweat it. The rest of what Obama did on November 20th, saying this is my high priority for deportation, which is gang members, violent felons, criminals.
Right.
My second highest priority, people with three misdemeanors, and people who either just got here after November 20th, 2014, or have a final order of deportation after January 2014. That's the second highest priority. The lowest priority are your people without a criminal history with a stale deportation order. So if you came here in 1995, entered without inspection, did an asylum case, you know, you had problems with the Jatio party, whatever, and you lost your case, you got ordered deported, but you never left, you're not being picked up for deportation unless you also have a criminal history. Those people are still okay.
That's great. That's how do you qualify for it, for DAPA?
Well, DAPA, if for DAPA, you have to be a parent of a resident or a citizen child and have been here for 5 years. You as of November 20th, 2014, and you qualify. And
well,
you can't have certain criminal history.
Correct. Yeah, there are certain criminal grounds that would render you ineligible for DACA. So if you have three misdemeanors, or one significant misdemeanor, or if you have any aggravated felony, right?
Correct.
So, you know, if you have a criminal history, or you're in the process of doing your criminal case, you really might need some immigration guidance before you take any pleas.
What about the documentations?
Yeah, the documentation is some kind of proof that you've been here. So if you came on a visa, that's easy, you have the proof. If you didn't come on a visa, you need to try to look for receipts for doctor records, hospital records, rent receipts, letters and affidavits from friends who know you.
If you sent money back home, then the receipt for the Western Union. The child was born here.
I see.
It's your child. Your name's on the birth certificate.
Interestingly enough, if you cannot be eligible for this by having a child after November 20th, 2014, however, you can accrue the 5 years after that date. So if...
Yeah, you can only accrue the 5 years up to January, because the president said you had to be here by January 1, 2010.
Right.
So you can't keep accruing the time beyond
after
that.
After that, okay.
Yeah.
So what if somebody comes on 2009?
2009 is fine, as long as they came in February 2010.
Doesn't matter.
Okay.
They're not going to qualify.
They're not going to qualify. I have one more question, but before I ask you the questions, I need to take one caller.
Sure.
All right. We have one caller from Delaware. Hello?
Hi, good evening. This is Joanna.
Hi, how are you?
My mom, good, you?
I'm good.
My mom applied for me and my sister when I was 17 and my sister was 21. In 2011, then I came here within 2 years, and my sister is still in Bangladesh. We call two or three times, they say, is it still in processing? But my mom applied together for us, and they say, my sister is now 23. So they say, it's a matter. So how can I deal with that?
Did you get the question?
Yeah, I think Eileen has it, right?
You got the question?
I didn't get the age, actually, of her sister. So obviously she came and she got
right
her green
card.
Right
now she's 23 years old.
She's 23 now, but she filed for her in 2011, I believe.
Right.
So it really, again, goes down to the formula. A couple of things. Is she a U.S. citizen who petitioned for her? I didn't get that part. But anyway, the date that the mother filed the visa petition and the date it got approved, the time between those two dates, the child gets to subtract from her age. If that brings her under the age of 21, then the visa number would probably be current. If it would keep her in the F2A category. I'm not really sure which category. Did you catch which category they would be in?
I didn't catch if the mother was a citizen.
Because if the mother was a citizen, she really had to adjust before.
She didn't mention any categories, though, I mean, either. So she was just saying that they applied in 2011.
So why don't you explain the visa bulletin a little bit in the different categories so people can get an idea?
Yeah, so I'll use this caller as an example. So obviously the one sister came. The other sister, I'm assuming, let's say she was a lawful permanent resident parent. Once the child turns 21, she would normally drop categories, and then it takes a lot longer. That category drops, and it becomes 2008 is the priority date. But if she can get back those
what's the priority date?
Right now it's July of 2008
for
a child who's over the age of 21, whose parent is just an OPR.
But what is a priority date?
Oh, you want...
Yeah, let's back it up. I think sometimes we have to, you know, you and I,
we
live
I
this,
apologize.
We breathe it,
okay.
We throw these numbers and terms around, and I think some of the audience would appreciate an explanation.
When somebody is, let's start with an immigrant, an immediate relative. Okay. So an immediate relative is a U.S. citizen filing for their spouse, their parent, and a child under the age of 21. Anybody else, if you apply for someone else outside of that immediate relative category, it goes into a preference category.
Right.
So what does that mean? That means that the Department of State has limited the number of visas for each each category.
Right.
So if I'm a U.S. citizen and my child's over 21 and I want to petition for them, it's not immediate. The visa numbers are not unlimited.
Right.
Now my child will have to wait. And they only give out like 108,000 visas, for example. I don't know the number off the top of my head.
When you say wait for how long?
Depending on how many applicants there are.
Okay.
So if they give 100, let's say for example, they give 100,000 visas away in that category, and they received 200,000 visas that year.
Mm-hmm.
Well, some people are going to get it.
Right.
And then as they get closer to the end of the fiscal year, the Department of State's going to roll back that number and say, instead of current, they're going to say, okay, we're only accepting visas, we're only accepting applications for people who filed a year ago, 2014 and before.
Right.
So as they start to see that more and more people are applying in an area, they have to monitor how many applications they get in. So the Department of State has this whole team of actuaries, if you ask me, who are figuring out how many applications they can receive in a given year. They only give out 100,000 applications. They've received, 50,000, but last year they had 100,000 left over. They have to manage how many applications they'll accept.
Right.
So each month they issue a visa bulletin and they say, okay, based on the number of applications we received, we're only accepting applications from, and in this case, first preference, that anybody who filed in August 1st, 2007 and before.
Right.
So that means that they must have 800,000 visas, applicants for 100,000 spots.
Quick question. Does it matter which state you're in?
No.
State doesn't matter, but some countries do matter.
I see.
So, for example, fortunately, Bangladesh is really not an exception. But India is, the Philippines are. Their numbers are much slower than everybody else because there's just so many people petitioning from that area. So just to back up a little bit, the immediate relative category has no limit. Mm-hmm. If I'm a citizen and I'm petitioning for a spouse,
right,
a child under 21 or a parent, right, there's no wait. There's no limit. And by no wait, we mean about a year. Or a year.
Just the processing time.
Just the processing time.
Just processing, right.
Okay. If I'm a resident petitioning for a resident, petitioning for a spouse, petitioning for a child, which are really the only two things a resident can do, the time is slower. If the child's under 21, it's faster than if the child's over 21. If I'm a citizen petitioning for a child over 21, it's one set of time. It's a different set of time if the child is married.
Right.
If I'm a brother petitioning for a brother or a sister, it's a different set of time. So all these are different categories. And people are always asking the question, I petitioned for my brother in 2005, how long do I have to wait? My mother petitioned for my brother who's 30 years old and not married. She's a resident. She just became a citizen. How long does she have to wait? These are questions that come up all the time. And it's a little bit complicated. So the one thing you need to know is the date that you file the application, the initial visa petition, that date becomes known as the priority date, the filing date and the priority date. That's going to be, when everything is approved, the date you use to find your place online in that category.
I see.
Okay. And that's really how the process goes. So sometimes people switch categories. I'm a resident parent petitioning for a child over 20. I'm in one category, I become a citizen, I keep the same priority date, I move to another category, then the person gets married, I keep the same priority date, and they move to a slower category.
I see.
So you can change the line you're on, but the priority date always stays the same.
But then why does it take, like for a son, when applies for her mother, or his mother, why does it take, it's about a year almost like?
That's just the processing time, because that's it. That's an immediate relative. And by immediate, we just mean the time to file the application to prove that you actually have that legal relationship and get the paperwork from here to DACA to process it. It's about a year.
Yeah, so for example, if you're an immediate relative, you can file all your applications right away.
But if you're not... Brother is also immediate.
No. For you and I, they're an immediate relative. For immigration, they're not immediate relatives.
For immigration...
Immigration, immediate relative is just those three people I told you, a spouse, a parent, and a minor child of a U.S. citizen.
That I understand, we understand, but I'm just for the audiences, because I have some people that are saying, oh, for my brother, it takes me about 5 to 10 years. For my mother...
It takes about 12 years.
Almost more than that. Well, actually, what is the priority date for the fourth preference brother and sister petition? I bet it's 2002 sometime.
It is 2002. I think it's May. May 15th.
It's about the same case when you have a stepbrother and sister?
Yeah. The relationship had to have started when the child was under 16, 18. Under 18 for a stepbrother and sister. So it's interesting. A stepchild can petition for a parent, again, as long as that relationship to the stepchild existed when the
under 18.
When the child was under 18. Right. So I could petition for my stepmom.
Right.
I'm a citizen. I'm over 21. I can now petition for her.
Right.
It's an immediate relative.
Right.
Even though she didn't give birth.
And for a stepbrother and sister, it will take that usual time,
years.
About 12 years.
Which is interesting. Okay, so back in the 60s, or 70s rather, it took maybe 3 months. It took 3 months for a brother-sister petition, but the sheer number of applications that they have for the amount of visas that they give out, it's expanded that time, that wait time, to 12 years. And in all these changes like DAPA and DACA, those are little band-aids because they want to have an immigration bill. Well, one of the discussions in the immigration bill is, let's get rid of that fourth preference category. So it may not be around forever. So if you have an opportunity to file for a brother or sister, you should do it.
You should do it. That's
because
great.
It may not be here 2 years from
the
now.
The proposal that the Senate made back in 2012 for their comprehensive bill, which passed the Senate, said, look, we're going to legalize people here, all this other stuff, but this fourth preference, brother and sister, we're going to end it. We're going to end it, but people who already filed, we're going to wrap them up in 3 years.
I see.
So we'll rush to get those people who now have a 12-year wait here, but we're not going to let anybody else petition for them.
And then I think they were going to use some of those visa numbers into the other category.
Right. So I always hear people say, gee, it's 12 years, I'm not going to do that. You know what? Do it and forget about it. Because if you don't do it, 12 years later, you're going to say, I wish I did it.
Right.
So time is going to go by either way. Whether you do it or you don't do it, 12 years is going by at the same rate. And then 12 years later, if your siblings aren't here.
Very shortly, I'm going to explain it to the audience in Bengali.
Yeah.
So that what we just talked about, I just wanted to let them know in short way.
Okay.
And we should give them that website. I mean, Eileen and I walk around with this all day long, looking at this chart every day, all day long.
It's the Department of State Visa Bulletin. And it changes every month.
That's great.
And just so you know, so you could explain to them, just because it says a date today doesn't mean the next month it's going to move forward.
Right.
It could move forward, it could stay the same, and it could move back.
Right.
The when it says C, it means current.
Right.
It means everybody can apply. When it says U, it means no one can apply. Unavailable.
And you see it here, Zalman. They have the categories.
Right.
And then you see some countries.
So they can go to the website and check.
Go to the website and check.
And
I have clients that
month.
Check it. Before I do. They're calling me up each month and saying, Mr. Bretz, I just checked. I'm getting close.
That's great. Darshak, I'm going to talk to you about immediate parents or relative. So, if you apply for your mother or brother, you can apply for your mother. So usually jeta hoy je mar jara immediate relative bolte hocche ge ma baba tader jonno shomoy ta komi lage ebong bhai bondher jonno shomoy ta beshi lage er age amra kotha bolchilam dapa ebong daka niye dapa ebong daka to hocche apnar basically je jader children ekhane born ebong citizen tader jonno jara 2010 er age এখানে আসছেন তো তাদেরকে এই দাপা এবং ডাকা অ্যাপ্লাই করে তো আমরা আরো কথা বলবো ব্রেটস এন্ড আইলিনের সাথে বাট তার আগে আমরা একজন কলার নিয়ে নিচ্ছি নাহার ক্যালিফোর্নিয়া থেকে নাহার
আসসালামু আলাইকুম
ওয়া আলাইকুম আসসালাম
হ্যাঁ এটা কি সরাসরি দেখাচ্ছে
না জি আপনার প্রশ্নটা বলুন আপনার প্রশ্নটা বলুন
হ্যাঁ আমি বলতেছি যে আমার ছোট ভাই জন আমি অ্যাপ্লাই করছি
আপনার ছোট ভাইয়ের বয়স কত
আমার
ছোট ভাইয়ের বয়স কত
আইডিয়া
নাই ওনার বয়স কত 40 30 কিরকম
এত
Only over 21, basically.
আচ্ছা
ওনার ফ্যামিলি আছে কি বললেন ওটা ওনার কি হয়ে যায় আপনি শিওর না আচ্ছা বাচ্চারা ওনার যে প্রথম তিন বাচ্চা ছেলে ওদের বয়স কত হবে ১৬ পড়বে বুঝতে পেরেছি আচ্ছা থ্যাংক ইউ নাহার আপনার প্রশ্নের জন্য আপনার উত্তর আমরা জেনে নিচ্ছি আইলিন এবং ব্রেটসের কাছ থেকে আপনি আমাদের সাথেই থাকুন. So she had a question. She applied for her brother. He's been married, and he has three kids. And recently, he had one daughter. But the adult kid, the oldest kid is he's 16 years old, and daughter is 11 years old, and so on. She applied around 2011. She's expecting if they cross. The oldest child, if he cross over 18 or more, it takes more than usual time, if they can come in with the family or not.
Yeah. So for derivative beneficiaries, children of the primary beneficiary.
Right.
As a general rule, once they're 21, mm-hmm. they're no longer included. The term is they age out.
So it has to be 21.
There is an exception.
Okay.
Everything with law is an exception. You have the rule and the exception, right?
Absolutely right.
So the exception is a little bit complicated. It's part of the Child Student Protection. What is it, CSPA? Child Status Protection Act, correct? See, this is why I depend upon Eileen.
That's great.
And perhaps you can explain it better than I, the one little exception.
Well, maybe or maybe not. So basically, they don't want to penalize the applicants for the lengthy time it takes during the application process. So what they say is, from the date you file your application to the date they approve it, they subtract all those days or years and days from the beneficiary's age to determine if they're still under the age of 21. If they would still be under the age of 21 when they subtract the processing time of the application from filing till approval,
right.
not until they're eligible to come, not until the
right.
visa number's current, from the approval of that visa petition, then they get to that new age now. So, but that age is constantly changing. So
right.
let's say it takes 2 years
right.
for the application from mm-hmm. filing to approval. Now my child is 22 years and 8 months and I'm eligible to come. You take the 2 years off of your child's age, they're 20 years and 8 months, they need to file it through the consulate, they need to notify the consulate, I'm about to age out, my son's aging out, my visa number is current, please process it soon. Because they still have to be completed with that process before they turn 21,
right.
even with the new age.
Yeah, so. On a fourth preference, a brother and sister petition, as she's describing, she filed that in 2011.
Right.
We know that they're now doing cases that were filed in 2002, 13 years. So if the numbers stay the same, which they probably won't, they'll probably
right.
get slower or faster, but if they stay the same, I don't know, my math is not that good, 2011 and 13.
About 9 years.
She's got about nine years to go.
So
that 16-year-old is going to be 25, right?
Yeah.
Potentially.
Okay. Now, but in fourth preferences, when you file it, they don't rush necessarily to approve it right away because they know they have time.
Mm-hmm.
So if they take 5 years to say it's approved, even though you still can't use it for many more years,
right.
that 5 years gets to be subtracted from the child's age. So will these kids be eligible? We don't know yet. Keeping that original I-130 with the filing date,
right.
the approval date,
right.
becomes very important.
Right. And the longer they take, the better. So a lot of people come and say, oh, I still didn't hear anything. You know what? You're in the fourth preference category. You don't need to hear anything. If it takes 6 years, I had one case, it took 8 years.
Wow.
Well, that's great. Because
the
now
children.
The children could be 27, 28, almost 29.
Right.
They can come.
I see.
And in no other world could that happen where 29-year-olds could come with their parents and be considered minors.
Correct.
Now,
that's
the only
great.
Way that they would no longer be eligible is if they married.
They marry.
Then that would be an issue. So the longer it takes to get approved, the better for the children of the original beneficiaries.
All right. Shortly, I'm going to explain it to her.
Okay.
Your question was, Narin, কতদিন লাগতে পারে, ইউজুয়ালি এটা 12 থেকে 13 বছর লাগে, সো এর ভেতরে যদি উনি ডেফিনেটলি যে যা কথা বললেন যে বড় ছেলে ১৬ বছর তো এটা যদি উইদিন পাঁচ বছরের ভিতরে যদি ওনার অ্যাপ্লিকেশন যদি অ্যাকসেপ্ট করে তাহলে সেখান থেকে এটা যদি ১৩ বছরও লাগে তো ওরা ওইখান থেকে পাঁচ বছর মাইনাস করবে তো সেই ক্ষেত্রে ওনার যে বড় যেই ছেলে আছে উনি মোস্ট লাইকলি এলিজিবল থাকবে এটা এখনও এই মুহূর্তে বলা যাচ্ছে না ডিপেন্ডিং আপনার অ্যাপ্লিকেশনটা আপনি কবে করেছিলেন Carrie, you have another caller. Eileen, you have another call. I'm going to take the call. From New York, Delaware. Delaware, New York, take a ball in. Hello?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
I'm here in Delaware. I'm here in Delaware.
কবে করেছিল ইয়ার বলেন আর ওনার বয়সটা বলেন জি ৯৭ উনি যখন করেছিল ওনার বয়স তখন কত ছিল হ্যাঁ আপনার ভাইদের জি ভুল কি ছিল আচ্ছা ওনারা যখন কাগজগুলো সাবমিট করেছিল কি ধরনের ভুল ছিল কাগজে
ভুল ছিল ধরেন ওই যে বার্থ সার্টিফিকেট একটা ভুল ছিল ওই যে মা চলে আসে আমেরিকা আগেছিল পরের দিনের ডেটে এফিডেভিট বার্থ সার্টিফিকেট নিয়েছে
আচ্ছা
তো এটা ভুল ছিল তারপরে ধরেন ওরা স্কুলে যখন স্কুলে পড়ছে ওই স্কুলের কাগজগুলো ওখানে ভুল দেওয়া হয়েছে
তো এখন ওনারা এটা আপনার অ্যাপ্লিকেশন গুলো ওনারা বাতিল করে দিয়েছে
আচ্ছা পরে আমি আবার আমি যেহেতু সিটিজেন এখন আমি আবার এদের জন্য ফাইল করছি লাস্ট ইয়ারে
আপনি লাস্ট ইয়ারে করেছেন মানে ২০১৪
জি
আপনার দুই ভাইয়ের জন্য
চার ভাই
ওনারা ওনাদের বয়স কত এখন
এখন তারা তিনজনে বিয়ে দিয়ে করছে ৩৫ সর্বোচ্চ ৩৫ আর নিচে ধরেন
২৫ আচ্ছা আমাদের সাথে থাকুন আমি আইলিন এবং ক্যারির কাছ থেকে জেনে নিচ্ছি আপনার এই প্রশ্নের উত্তরগুলো ধন্যবাদ আগে So the question for this gentleman, her mother applied 97, around 97. They got all approved, but just because of some small mistakes, the birth certificate, the schools, or everything was kind of, you know, it wasn't right. So they disclosed that case. It was gone, completely gone. So now he applied again, a brother actually, on 2014. So his question is, now they're turning to adults, most of them are, between 35 to 25, all four brothers. Most of them are married. And his question is, what can be done at this moment?
Well, this raises a lot of issues. First of all, this is the fourth preference, a brother petitioning for brothers and sisters.
Right, at this moment. But previously in 97, actually, his mother applied for them, but it was denied because of those of miss.
Right. So first thing, brother petition. We're running about 13 years right now.
Right.
Second thing, it may have been denied for mistakes, but probably was denied for fraud, for misrepresentation. If they alleged something and provided certificates of birth that weren't accurate. Or were produced just to get through the process.
Most probably, he was saying it wasn't accurate. It wasn't matching what
Right. So why? As a general rule, if the documents are not exactly what they're supposed to be, and the consulate figures that out, the consul generally does not say we deny this for mistake. They say we deny it for misrepresentation. And we would need to investigate that to know for sure why. If there was a misrepresentation on the part of these beneficiaries who were denied and who are now becoming beneficiaries on the fourth preference, you can get a waiver of that, but only if you have a spouse or a parent who is a citizen or a resident. So they may not be eligible if there was a misrepresentation, or we may need to challenge that finding that there was a misrepresentation and that it was actually more of a mistake. So whatever happened in that 97 case needs to be investigated and clarified while this petition is pending, so they don't get their hopes up falsely, or if there's a problem, there's time to try to correct it.
Anything you want to add to it, Eileen?
Yeah, I agree that it sounds like it's probably a misrepresentation, and I'd want to see if it's still possible to have that reconsidered, or if the mother was the one who petitioned for them in 97 and there was a misrepresentation, they were eligible for a waiver. So did the consulate tell them you're eligible for a waiver of misrepresentation? Because the petitioner sounds like she's the mother.
And maybe it was more like a mistake or just sloppy work on behalf of whoever was preparing it.
If it was because somebody forgot to file within a deadline and then they destroyed the visa, that's a very different issue. Because they destroy visas if they don't hear from people within a year.
So what you guys are saying, that if they have some kind of proof, case can be reopened?
Well, not necessarily. I'd like to see where it's at, because when did it, as you said, it's gone.
Right now he applied again on 2014.
Right. So but in 1997 case.
The old case was around 97.
That old case doesn't go away for purposes of whether or not whatever happened there would make them ineligible on this application.
Right. If he's inadmissible there, he's inadmissible in the future.
Right.
The question then becomes, was it a LPR parent petitioning and then they married? Well, then the paperwork says, and if they lied and tried to say they were still single, that's a misrepresentation. Or once the government figured out they're married, well, then they're no longer eligible, because a lawful permanent resident can't petition for a married child.
If it was a mistake, like on date of birth, then why was that mistake? And let's see.
And it's usually a fraudulent reason.
It's usually done for a particular reason, to keep somebody under a certain age, or somebody's not who they say they are. So we really need to try to clarify. In a case like this, what we would do in this office is conduct an investigation on the 97 case, and then get that clarified to see whether we could revive it, or how it's going to affect the current case.
Okay. All right, Delaware, আপনার যে প্রশ্নটি ছিল যে 97 এগেস্ট মেবি এটা নিয়ে ওনারা ডিসকাশন করতে যাচ্ছে, তো সেই ক্ষেত্রে আপনি তাদের সাথে যোগাযোগ করতে পারেন, বাট তার আগে আপনাকে জানিয়ে দিচ্ছি আপনি চাইলে তাদের সাথে যোগাযোগ করতে পারেন। আপনি যে অ্যাপ্লাইটি করেছেন 2014 সেটি এখনো আপনি যেহেতু ওনাদের ও আপনার মা 97 অ্যাপ্লাই করেছিল, তো সেক্ষেত্রে যেহেতু ওনাদের নাম এবং ফাইল সব কিছু রেকর্ডে আছে, তো সেক্ষেত্রে এখনও যদি ওই সেম নামই থাকে, সব কিছুই একই থাকে, তো তারা ওই ফলটি পড়বে। তো আমার অ্যাডভাইস আপনাকে হবে, এটাই দিব যে আপনি এই কেসটি নিয়ে ভালো একজন লয়ারের সাথে আলাপ করুন, এবং চাইলে এবং আপনি ওনাদের সাথে আলাপ করতে পারেন, ব্রেটস অ্যান্ড কোভেন এলএলসি, এবং তারা হয়তো বা আপনাকে একটা ভালো একটা অ্যাডভাইস দিবে, যে অ্যাডভাইসে হয়তো বা আপনি একটা ভালো কোনো রাস্তা পেয়ে যাবেন। তো সেক্ষেত্রে আমি আপনাকে বলবো যে আপনি একজন ভালো লয়ারের সাথে আলাপ করেন, ডেফিনেটলি। এই যেহেতু এটা পুরনো কেস, বেসিক্যালি 97 কেস, সেটা আবার আপনি 2014 অলমোস্ট সেম, সো কোনো ডিফারেন্স হবে না যেহেতু আগে ফল্ট হয়েছে। তো আপনি চাইলে ব্রেটস অ্যান্ড কোভেনের সাথে যোগাযোগ করতে পারেন, আমাদের স্ক্রিনে ব্রেটস অ্যান্ড কোভেনের ইনফরমেশনে দেওয়া আছে, তাদের টেলিফোন নাম্বারটা হচ্ছে 1212-267-2555, এবং তাদের অফিসে একজন বাঙালি আছেন যিনি বাংলায় ট্রান্সলেশন করে থাকেন, ওনার নাম হচ্ছে শাহিন। তো আপনি আপনার কেস নিয়ে তাদের সাথে আলাপ করতে পারেন এবং তাদের সাথে ফুললি ডিসকাস করতে পারেন আপনার এই কেসটি নিয়ে। সামির উদ্দিন নিউ জার্সি থেকে, হ্যালো।
হ্যালো,
জি আসসালামু আলাইকুম।
ওয়ালাইকুম আসসালাম, শুভ সন্ধ্যা।
জি, আপনার নামটি বলুন।
আমার নাম সামির উদ্দিন।
মনির উদ্দিন, সরি, জি
সামির উদ্দিন।
পনির
সামির, এস এ
সরি সমীর ভাই, আমি এক্সট্রিমলি সরি, আপনার নাম আপনি আপনার প্রশ্নটি বলুন।
হ্যাঁ, আমার প্রশ্নটি হচ্ছে আমার শাশুড়ি গত অক্টোবরে আসছেন আমেরিকা, আমার ওয়াইফ অ্যাপ্লাই করে
রাখছেন। আপনার শাশুড়ি কবে এসেছেন?
অক্টোবরে আসছেন পুনরায়।
অক্টোবরে কবে?
অক্টোবরে 25 তারিখ পুনরায় এখানে আসছেন।
কোন সালে?
2014
এ।
হ্যাঁ
জি।
তো আসার পর আমার খালি একটা অর্থাৎ আমার শাশুড়ির মেয়ে একটা, তার বয়স ছিল মানে 21 এর নিচে, আইসা উনি অ্যাপ্লাই করতেন।
আপনার শাশুড়ি ওনার ওনার মেয়ের জন্য অ্যাপ্লাই করেছেন?
হ্যাঁ, সে অবিবাহিত, তখন তার বয়স 21 এর নিচে ছিল, এখন তার বয়স 21 হয়ে গেছে।
অ্যাপ্লাই করেছিল কবে? উনি আসছেন 2014 এ, উনি অ্যাপ্লাই করেছেন কবে?
হ্যাঁ, 2014 এ অ্যাপ্লাই করেছে। উনি উনি অক্টোবরে আসছেন, অ্যাপ্লাই করা হয়েছে ডিসেম্বরে।
আপনার শাশুড়ি কি সিটিজেন?
না, সিটিজেন না, উনি রিসেন্টলি আসছেন।
আমি আপনার প্রশ্নটি বুঝতে পারিনি। আপনার শাশুড়ি আসছে এবং ওনার মেয়ের জন্য উনি অ্যাপ্লাই করেছে, বাট আপনার শাশুড়ির স্ট্যাটাসটা কি? এখানে কি সিটিজেন?
উনি উনি গ্রিন কার্ড হোল্ডার।
আচ্ছা, আপনার শাশুড়ি হচ্ছেন গ্রিন কার্ড হোল্ডার, সিটিজেন না?
হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ না।
আচ্ছা, উনি অ্যাপ্লাই করেছে ওনার মেয়ের জন্য এবং ওনার মেয়ে হচ্ছে গিয়ে 20 বছরের নিচে এই মুহূর্তে।
21 বছরের নিচে ছিল আগে, এখন কিন্তু 21 বছর উপরে হতো।
আচ্ছা, উনি যখন উনি উনি যখন অ্যাপ্লাই করেছে অক্টোবরের, আপনি অক্টোবরে বলতে বোঝাচ্ছেন গত বছরে অক্টোবর মাসে উনি অ্যাপ্লাই যখন করেছিলেন, এটা কি মাসে অ্যাপ্লাই করেছিলেন?
ডিসেম্বর মাসে অ্যাপ্লাই করেছিলেন।
ডিসেম্বর মাসে
9 তারিখ অ্যাপ্লাই করেছিলেন।
আচ্ছা, ডিসেম্বরে অ্যাপ্লাই করেছিলেন, ঠিক আছে। তো আপনার তো আপনি এখন কি জানতে যাচ্ছেন বলেন?
এখন জানতে চাচ্ছি আমার শাশুড়ি যখন আমার ওয়াইফের অ্যাপ্লাইয়ে কিন্তু আমার শাশুড়ি আসছেন, তো ওনারা যখন ভিসা নিতে চান ঢাকাতে, তখন এমবেসিতে বলছিলেন যে আমার তো মেয়ে একটা আন্ডারেজ, এখন ওর সম্পর্কে কি করতে পারি? তো ওনারা বলছিলেন যে আপনি ওইখানে যাওয়ার পরে গ্রিন কার্ড পাওয়ার পর যখন আপনি অ্যাপ্লাই করবেন সম্ভবত 1 বছরের ভিতরে হয়ে যেতে পারে। এখন আইসা ওইখানে কিন্তু ডিসেম্বরে তার জন্য অ্যাপ্লাই করা হয়েছে। এখন আমার প্রশ্ন হচ্ছে আপনার কাছে যে কতদিনের ভিতরে আশা করা যায়?
আচ্ছা, ধন্যবাদ।
আরেকটা প্রশ্ন আছে।
জি বলেন।
আমার 2 নম্বর প্রশ্ন হচ্ছে আমার আপন শালা অর্থাৎ আমার শাশুড়ি ছোট ছেলে, তার বয়স 30, তার জন্য অ্যাপ্লাই করছেন কিন্তু আমার ওয়াইফ আজ 2 বছর আগে কিন্তু অ্যাপ্লাই করছেন, অলরেডি তার জন্য অ্যাপ্লাই করা আছে।
আপনার আপনার ওয়াইফ ওনার ভাইয়ের জন্য অ্যাপ্লাই করেছে?
হ্যাঁ, ভাইয়ের জন্য অ্যাপ্লাই করছেন 2 বছর আগে।
2 বছর আগে, 2 বছর আগে ওনার আপনার 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 ওয়াইফের ভাইয়ের বয়স কত?
তার বয়স এখন 30।
এখন 30।
হ্যাঁ
আচ্ছা, তো 2 বছর আগে ওনার বয়স 28 ছিল বেসিক্যালি।
আচ্ছা
জি।
তো এখন আমার প্রশ্ন হচ্ছে সে এই মুহূর্তে আমেরিকাতে মানে ভিজিটে আসতে যাচ্ছে,
ভিজিট ভিসা,
কিভাবে তার জন্য অ্যাপ্লাই করা যায় বা কিভাবে সহজতায় সে আসতে পারে?
আচ্ছা, ধন্যবাদ সমীর ভাই আপনাকে প্রশ্ন করার জন্য। আপনি আমাদের সাথেই থাকুন, আমরা চেষ্টা করছি আপনার প্রশ্নের উত্তরগুলো নেওয়ার জন্য আইলিন এবং ব্র্যাচের কাছ থেকে। So gentleman had a question. Her mother-in-law came in on 2014 on October, and when she was in the embassy in Dhaka, she mentioned that her she have daughter which is underage, and when she came here in October 2014, she applied for her daughter around December. So now she's green card holder. Now the gentleman wants to know that the processing time for that.
They're at 2013 right now, so it's actually less than 2 years because she's under 21.
Right now she's 21. Right now she's 21, but when she applied around December 2014, she wasn't 21.
So and she just turned 21 in the last 2 months?
I think so, probably. And
well,
question, she's a green card holder, she's not a citizen.
Right, a green card holder petitioning for a minor child only takes 2 years.
2 years.
Yeah, but okay. She turned 21.
Right.
So, I mean, she's only able to add back in the time from the time she filed the application until it gets approved.
I see.
And then she'll have to subtract that from her age.
estimated?
On a petition for an F2A filing, I mean, mm-hmm. they're probably going to adjudicate that application in 6 months.
6 months. So 6 months from there. Okay.
So she's probably going to convert to an F2B. And an F2B is going to take now several years.
And
because you're saying she came in October, she filed in
December.
And
right.
then the girl turned 21 in less than 2 months.
Right.
Yeah. She's going to change categories. It's going to go from 2013, June of 2013, all the way to July of 2008.
Wow. And
that's like a 5 year difference.
His wife applied for his brother in 2012, but they want him to come in earlier than that with any kind of visa, like example, visa.
Well, he could always apply for a visitor visa. But okay. once there's a visa petition for right. an immigrant visa
right.
pending,
mm-hmm.
the likelihood of getting that is slim.
Right.
He could also try to do an E visa if he wants to come over here and invest,
okay.
E2 visa.
Mm-hmm.
Depending on the age of the brother, if he's
right now he's 30.
Oh, 30. You know, if he was coming to go back to school, he could try and do a student visa
right.
and come in on that.
Okay.
The E visa is the one that allows him to come and work for those 10 years while he waits to get his green
mm-hmm.
card. But he has to invest some money into a business and then work that business.
I see. All right. Samir, apnar je proshno chilo ebong uttorti hocche unara dicchen je basically apnar shashuri je apply korechen she apply er response jodi 6 mashe jodi accept hoye thake tahole seta 6 mash subtract hobe oi application er date theke, so which is I think uni safe zone e achen, but still eta ei muhurte bola ta সম্ভব না, যেহেতু আনলেস আপনারা কোনো ধরনের কনফার্মেশন যদি ইমিগ্রেশন থেকে না পেয়ে থাকেন। এবং দ্বিতীয় প্রশ্নের যে উত্তরটা আপনার প্রশ্নটি ছিল ওনার যে ভিজিট ভিসা আসতে পারবে কিনা, ইয়েস উনি ভিজিট ভিসা অ্যাপ্লাই করে দেখতে পারে এবং চাইলেও উনি যদি ইনভেস্ট যদি করতে চায় E2 ভিসা সেটা হচ্ছে গিয়ে উনি সেখানেও ট্রাই করে দেখতে পারে। সেক্ষেত্রে আপনারা চাইলে আমাদের এই ব্রেটস অ্যান্ড লয়ের অফিসে তারা যোগাযোগ করতে পারেন এবং ওনাদের অফিসে বাংলায় ট্রান্সলেশন করার জন্য একজন আছেন, ওনার নাম হচ্ছে মিস শাহিন। আপনারা তাদের সাথে যোগাযোগ করতে পারেন যে কোনো সময় তাদের অফিস ম্যানহাটনে। সো অ্যাজ উই ওয়ার টকিং অ্যাবাউট দাপা অ্যান্ড দাকা, মাই কোয়েশ্চেন ওয়াজ অ্যাকচুয়ালি লেট মি গো ব্যাক টু মাই নোট। Okay. The documentation we're talking about for DAPA and DACA, if those documentation, if it's not in English, if it's some other languages, how do you prove that? How do you take that and?
Anything with any governmental agency, you have to have translated, and it has to be a certified translation. So you do not have to go to a professional and expensive translation service, but somebody who translated must certify that they are competent to translate from Bangladesh into English. And that's pretty standard with anything you do with immigration, whether it's a birth certificate, a death certificate, a letter from a family or friend, or any document, anything you would add to that.
And the person who was arrested before was in criminal charged, anything?
So on every immigration application, and by the way, this is a great question, and this is something that we really spend a lot of time on in my office, and I lecture on a lot to other lawyers on how to do cases where there's some immigration cases where there's some criminal crossover. Every immigration application has a question: have you ever been arrested? Yes. If the answer is yes, please provide a certified certificate of disposition. So anytime you're arrested, and what does an arrest mean? It means that you've lost your liberty. You've been taken into custody. Perhaps you've been handcuffed. Almost for sure, you've been fingerprinted. And so you have to get a disposition for that.
Mm-hmm.
Being arrested doesn't make you ineligible. And it's not hard to get arrested in New York City. People get arrested pretty easily in this city. And it depends upon how the case was adjudicated and finished. And so certain adjudications will make you ineligible for many immigration benefits. almost any controlled substance conviction, except for simple possession of 30 grams or less of marijuana. Cocaine, sale, all of those are going to make you ineligible for just about anything. Any crimes of violence, assault, robbery, burglary, sex offenses may make you ineligible, but there may be waivers available depending upon what you're doing. Oddly enough, historically, driving while intoxicated, driving while under the influence, was never a bar to immigration benefits, but is to DACA and DAPA. So anybody who is not a citizen who has an open criminal case should consult an immigration lawyer in addition to their criminal lawyer before they make decisions on their criminal case, because it could affect their status, even if they already have a green card. And that's really the overview.
Question for Eileen, that if somebody wants to invest in an e-visa, if they can also get like self-employed status on that, like?
Well, an e-visa holder, they invest in a business. And right. when they set up that business, like, they're able to work that business. So they get like to file their own taxes. It would say self-employed, or owner, you know. President, however they're going to set up their business. It really depends on how they set it up. So if they set it up as a partnership, they're going to get a K-1 at the end of the year, and then their title is self-employed partner, owner, etc.
Oh, that's great. Mustafa from New York. I'm going to take one caller. Mustafa, do you have any questions? Hello.
Can you repeat your question, please?
আপনার বোনের জন্য অ্যাপ্লাই করেছেন 2005 এ
জি
জি বলেন
এখন এখন তো আমার প্রশ্ন হলো যে 2005 এর নভেম্বরে অ্যাপ্লাই করতে আর কতদিন লাগবে আমার এই কেসটা প্রসেস হইতে থাকতে
আপনার বোন কত বছর
জি
আপনার বোনের উনার বয়স কত
বিবাহিত উনি বয়স হবে 38.
উনার বয়স হচ্ছে 38. আপনি অ্যাপ্লাই করেছেন 2005 এ?
জি.
আচ্ছা ধন্যবাদ.
আমার ওর সাথে দুইটা ভাগিনে আছে.
আচ্ছা.
অ্যাপ্লিকেশনের সাথে একবার বয়স হলো 18 বছর আর একটা বয়স হলো 20 বছর.
আচ্ছা.
তো ওরা কি ওই কেসে আসতে পারবে?
ওনার যে ছেলে মেয়ে আছে 18-20 ওনাদের কি এখন 18 এবং 20 নাকি যখন 2005 ওনাদের বয়স ছিল 18 এবং 20?
না এখন চলতেছে
18 এবং 20. ধন্যবাদ মুস্তফা আপনাকে কল করার জন্য, আমাদের সাথে থাকুন। ক্যারি, ইন শর্ট, উই ডোন্ট হ্যাভ আ টাইম, অর আইলিন, এনি ওয়ান ইউ ক্যান অ্যানসার ইট, হি অ্যাপ্লাইড ফর হিজ সিস্টার অ্যান্ড শি ইজ 38 ইয়ার্স ওল্ড, অরাউন্ড 2005, সো দ্য কিডস নাও দে আর 18 অ্যান্ড 20 ইয়ার্স ওল্ড, ইফ দে ক্যান কাম ইন উইথ হার সিস্টার, কোয়েশ্চন number one, and second is how long will it take?
Right, so this is the common theme that seems to come up a lot. So this is what's called the fourth preference category, the brother and sister category. It's roughly running 13 years. That number could change. They're doing people who filed sometime in 2002. This is a 2005 filing.
Right.
So we're at least another 3 years
three
away.
3 years from right.
And then the question is, and we don't know the answer from the caller, we'd have to take a look at the paperwork,
right?
The date of the filing in 2005, the date it was approved. We don't know if it was approved in 2 years or in 5 years or 6 years.
When
gets to be subtracted from the age.
Right.
So we think we're 3 years away. The one kid is 20. The other is 18, I think.
Right. 18 and 20s.
18 and 20. So the 18-year-old probably is going to be pretty close to 21 and gets the additional time from when it was approved.
Right.
If it's 1 year, he's going to be great. The 20-year-old is going to need, about 3 years, right? So we really need to see that original I-130. There is my experience tells me there's a very good chance the two kids will qualify,
right?
But we need to see dates the of the approval.
Right. What if it takes, the approval that was within a year?
Then likely both of them will not be eligible. Maybe the 18-year-old will be close.
The
first one will not. So what will happen in that case
is
the sibling will come here. Mm-hmm. The day they enter the U.S., I shouldn't say that, a couple of days after they enter the U.S., when they actually have their physical green card in their hand, they can then go ahead and file the I-130 for their child, and they'll have to wait for that to become current.
Question, I mean, I know we don't have a time, but still, I just wanted to, for curiosity.
You got great questions, so it's
obvious. The 2005, like, let's say I applied for my brother, and what's, how they determine that that this case will take 1 year to prove, this case will take 2 years to prove, this case will take 3 years to prove?
You know, there isn't logic. There isn't one line for all these applications.
Right.
I worked for what was the former Immigration and Naturalization Service for several years, many, many years ago. You know, some of the applications go to this examiner, some of them go to this examiner, some of them go to this examiner. This guy knocks his work off faster than this guy. This guy got sent on a detail down to Texas because he had to help with the children crossing the border. So there's no, we can file two applications
from
two different brothers on the same day.
Right.
We know they're both going to take 13 years.
Right.
But this one gets approved in 3 years. And this one gets approved in 7 years.
Wow.
I don't know the answer why. There's no logic.
There's no logic behind this.
Yeah, by the way, anything with immigration, Zaman, and this can be the tip for tonight since we need to do
a tip. I was
going to
ask you that.
Anything with immigration, if you look for logic, you're going to be wrong. There's no logic in immigration.
All right, there's no doubt. All right, Eileen, any tip from you?
Oh, no, I think one tip is enough.
One tip is enough. All right, I'm going to answer his question.
Sure.
So, Mustafa, আপনার যে কোশ্চেনটা ছিল, most likely যদি depend করছে যে আপনার এই কেসটি কবে approve হয়েছে, ওই depend-এর উপরে. Usually, আপনি যেটা apply করেছেন 2005-এ, it takes about 13 বছর, 13 years. So, 2005, another, let's say, 3 years or so time lagbe. Ebong onader je chele me ache 18 theke 20 bochor, most likely onara hoy toba make korte parbe as long as depend koreche ge again approval apnar case ti 2005 e pore onara kobe approve korechen, ek bochor pore na 3 bochor pore na 5 bochor pore, ei oi bochore minus kore then oi hisab oi tar upor depend kore onara apnar ei boner sathe ashte parbe. Thank you for a question. Carrie, we're going to end up the show. Before we go, question. As you know, we do this in call Bangladeshi channels. If somebody goes to your office and in person, and how do you basically, a person goes to your office, how do you approach him or her, and how do you basically guide her? And basically, if somebody is in poor in English, how do you approach those persons in your office, handle them?
This is a really good question, and immigration is complicated and personal.
Right.
The first thing you need to know is all consultations are confidential.
Right.
By law,
we
cannot disclose it to third parties.
Absolutely.
So whatever you tell us, we can't reveal that.
Right.
Secondly, we have, at this point, we have about 15 different languages in the office, including Bangla, Hindi, Punjabi, and a whole variety of other languages. So we accommodate our clients from Bangladesh in Bangla.
Right.
Some of them are also very proud of their English skills and prefer. A lot of the consultations that we do with people from Bangladesh, we do it in English, with a Bangla interpreter standing by, and they are very comfortable with Eileen and myself, but often then want to work with the Bangla interpreter privately on preparing the applications and stuff. The second thing is that we're in business about 20 years. I've been practicing law almost 25. Eileen, I don't know, a little bit less, but she's much brighter than I am.
Right.
And so what we try to do is go through a very methodical, non-rushed, the consultation is not rushed, a very methodical history of when you came to the U.S., how you came, what applications, what you did with immigration, and what family you have here, whether there's any criminal history, whether you've been a victim of a crime, which might create benefits,
right,
and then sort out what the possibilities are. And very often people from Bangladesh, they're some of my favorite clients, because I think my observation of knowing a lot of different ethnic groups, you're basically very hardworking people and very family oriented. But right. I often see sometimes people do what they have to do to get here. So we often see where people may have used a slightly different version of their name, or have two or three versions of their name, or may have done a marriage case that wasn't really exactly a real marriage case. And now they've been in the U.S. for 20 years. Their children are teenagers. They own two taxi cabs. They own a business. They're living the American dream, but they need to fix their paperwork. So we see that a lot.
Right.
And those cases, we often have a solution for by coming clean.
Right.
By rectifying all of the earlier mistakes. And that we're very proud of. So people should feel very comfortable coming. And right now, although we normally charge a $275 consultation fee, right now we are not charging fees for our listeners on this show, and it's been fun, by the way.
That's great. That's good to know. All right, thank you for coming in today,
Mr.
Carey and Eileen. Thank you.
Thank you, as always.
All right. দর্শক, যেতে যেতে আপনাদেরকে জানিয়ে দিচ্ছি যে ওনাদের অফিসে আপনাদের যত কেস আছে ওনারা কনফিডেনশিয়ালি হ্যান্ডেল করে, উইথ মিনস হচ্ছে কি ওনারা প্রাইভেসির সাথে, এবং ওনাদের আপনাদের কেসটি নিয়ে ওনারা বাহিরে অথবা থার্ড পার্সন কার সাথে আলাপ আলোচনা করেও না, এবং এটা বা এগেনস্ট দ্য ল। তো দর্শক, আপনারা যদি ওনাদের সাথে ব্রেটস এন্ড কোভেনের সাথে ডিসকাশন করতে চান, ওনাদের অফিসের নাম্বারটি হচ্ছে আমাদের স্ক্রিনে আপনারা দেখতে পাচ্ছেন 212-267-2555। ওনাদের অফিসটা হচ্ছে 305 ব্রডওয়ে সুইট নাম্বার 100, নিউ ইয়র্ক 1111, ও সরি অ্যাগেন নিউ ইয়র্ক 10007। সো আপনারা চাইলে তাদের সাথে ফোন করে আপনার কেসটি নিয়ে ডিসকাশন করতে পারেন। দর্শক, আজ এই পর্যন্তই, দেখা হবে আগামী সপ্তাহে উইথ মিস্টার ক্যারি অ্যান্ড মিস আইলিন। সেই পর্যন্ত দর্শক ভালো থাকুন, সুস্থ থাকুন।